Thank you for joining us. I'm Carla Thorson, and it's my great pleasure to introduce tonight's guest. Robert Wirth is a frequent contributor to the New York Times Magazine and the New York Review of Books. He spent 14 years as a correspondent for the New York Times and was the paper's Beirut bureau chief from 2007 to 2011. He has twice been a finalist for the National Magazine Award. Mr. Wirth's book, which we're here to discuss tonight on the Arab Spring and its aftermath, is called A Rage for Order, The Middle East in Turmoil from Tahrir Square to ISIS. It was published just recently.
Let's see.
A few days.
Two days ago.
2 days ago. So you are among the vanguard who will be hearing more about the book tonight. So please join me in welcoming Robert Wirth for a conversation about civilian life and political conflict in the Middle East. So thank you so much again for joining us, Robert. And there really has been a great deal of attention focused on the five-year anniversary of the Arab Spring, how the promise of revolutionary change that began in Tunisia and Egypt in 2011 touched off successive popular movements and unrest, leading to regime change, and how this has given way to turmoil, to use your own term, and to disillusionment, I would argue. So in the United States, we tend to focus on what our government, what our role has been in the region, and the degree to which U.S. intervention in Iraq caused the dominoes to fall in Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Yemen, Syria, the countries that you focus on. And your work on these countries and the events that unfolded there over the past 5 years, in your own work, you've taken a much different approach in trying to understand it better. So I'm hoping you can offer us a firsthand experience. And what do you think is most important and perhaps least reported about the events of the last 5 years?
Well, I certainly feel that they're indigenous movements and that the U.S. had very little to do with them. But their causes are very complicated and go back an awfully long time. I think one of the paradoxes of the Arab regimes is that they were simultaneously very, very strong and very, very weak. They were tremendously powerful at crushing opposition and snuffing out dissent, sometimes before people could even articulate it. But they were very weak in the sense that people didn't believe in them very strongly. The book is dedicated to a man named Muhammad al-Mutawakkil, who was a Yemeni political figure. And I once asked him about this years ago. And he was an elderly man who'd been involved in almost every political regime in Yemen since the 60s. And he said part of it is that these governments, the Republican regimes, and after all, they're all quite similar. There's a real pattern in Egypt and Yemen and Syria and Iraq and others. Many of them came, and this isn't particularly true of Yemen, they followed a regime that had a certain, it was sort of almost a divine sanction. It was a religiously ordained monarchy that had been in place for 1,000 years. And then it was suddenly followed by, in Yemen's case, by a very uneducated military man who saw himself as a jumped up nobody and was constantly looking over his shoulder thinking, you know, who's gonna take me out? And that's part of the reason why they behaved in such a paranoid fashion. We're just constantly killing off challengers. Why suddenly these regimes collapsed? I think they actually had been rotting for a long time. And my take basically on what happened in 2011 was that this was less a revolution in the sense that a carefully planned insurrection than states that had really been sort of losing their ability to repress as well as they had in the past. I think, 10, 20 years earlier, they might have had the ability to turn this back. But they had become so corrupt that, the Ba'ath Party in Syria was no longer capable of doing what it had done. you know, the economics are a big part of this as well. And I think that actually is something that less attention has been paid to. You know, you had so many people who were so poor, and not just, there was a history, I mean, in Egypt, for instance, you had masses and masses of poor people who are mostly invisible, living way out in the countryside. But over decades, more and more people had moved to the cities, and that accelerated in recent years. In Syria, for instance, you had this terrible drought that lasted for 4 years. And when the last time I was in Syria before the uprisings was in late 2010, and you saw loads and loads of people who'd been forced off the land because they couldn't make a living anymore. And they were sort of living huddled in tents in the major cities of Syria. And even then, there were some people who were saying, you know, something terrible is going to happen.
So for the people that you met, and I want to start with Egypt because it really is where it started, but also where you start talking about this. Are there common motivations from among all of the people that you met, and just in what inspired them to go out in the street? I mean, they may not have understood the effect it was going to have, but they were seeking something at that moment that they decided to go out and...
Yeah. Well, I think that's interesting. There's something deceptive about that, because what we tended to hear over here at that time was a discourse of civil rights and democracy and dignity, even, you know, more specific stuff about reforming thuggish, corrupt bureaucracies and so forth. And that was true of the sort of first wave, the kind of pioneers of this insurrection. They tended to be middle class, well-educated, people like Wael Khonaim, the famous Egyptian Google employee who started the website We're All Khalid Said, that was all really inspired by a response to police brutality. So you had, on the one hand, this very well-articulated defense of the protests. But they really became mass protests when loads of people who were not necessarily middle class or educated joined in. And in fact, much of what made that happen in Egypt was when the Brotherhood, which is this mass movement and highly organized, joined the protests. And those people were not interested in a secular democratic state. And many of the people who showed up who were not Brotherhood were very, very poor. And what they wanted was a better life. You know, they wanted bread, literally. A lot of them would use that word. But there was a kind of a momentum behind the original goals that had been articulated so well by those middle-class educated people. And I think that in that moment, people felt those goals were what had gotten the world's attention. And there was a genuine feeling, let's all rally behind this. Let's all stand behind, you know, that version of this revolution. There were moments, in fact, when some Islamists, before Mubarak fell, would be in a crowd of people who were chanting for, you know, democracy and freedom. And I remember hearing somebody at one point saying, Islamic State, Islamic State. And everybody said, shut up, shut up. You know, that's not the message. Mm-hmm. And I think people went along with the democracy rhetoric, again, for the most part, not because they were trying to fool anybody, but because it felt like the unifying message. It felt like the one that made sense. After Mubarak was out, a lot of people slipped back, just quite naturally, I think, into the things that they valued, which was quite often a more Islamic rhetoric, not necessarily so. But a lot of people also who had come to the protests because they wanted something, they wanted sustenance, essentially. And when they began to feel that this wasn't really changing anything, they gave up. And that was true in Egypt and in other countries as well.
Mm, fascinating. So in Egypt, Egypt is really the first of the dominoes to fall. Why was Egypt such an important country that acted as a catalyst for the other countries in the Middle East, for the events that followed among its neighbors?
Well, Egypt has always had that role. I think, you know, it's the most populous of all the Arab countries. And it's been seen as a vanguard, a leader for a long time. You know, everybody watches Egyptian movies in the Arab world. And for decades, Gamal Abdel Nasser, who's the sort of the central figure of Arab nationalism, was was seen in almost as a leader of the entire Arab world. And after he came to power in the 1952 revolution, he inspired copycat revolutions elsewhere. And in fact, the Egyptian military helped to foment those revolutions in Yemen and Iraq and other places. So Egypt has always led the way culturally and other ways that were seen as a frontline state against Israel, and that mattered a lot. Of course, that changed over the years. You know, they made the Camp David deal, and Egypt stagnated economically and politically. It was seen as, you know, sort of somehow no longer an inspiration to Arabs. So this was actually one of the backgrounds to the revolt, was a feeling that Egypt, this noble country, you know, Umm ad-Dunya, the mother of the world, is the way people described it, was no longer what it ought to be.
So in Egypt, as the revolution unfolded, the military sort of still provided some institutional framework for the state. I mean, there was this interlude where the Muslim Brotherhood took power and then lost it again, and the military really has remained in power in Egypt, even as Mubarak is gone. But in Libya, with the overthrow of Gaddafi, there was really a void. So what makes the outcome in Libya so much different than what happened in Egypt? And what do you see, based on your own understanding and conversations with people in Libya, what the greatest challenge is for those seeking justice on the one hand and a new regime or some form of a new regime there?
Well, the army is sort of a blessing and a curse for Egypt. It's very, very strong. It's almost a kind of alternative society within a society. Mm-hmm. It's very autocratic. The leaders of the army have for a long time felt that, you know, ordinary Egyptians are basically sheep and the army's the shepherds, and they'll do what we tell them. And that was why the revolution in Egypt wasn't really a revolution. It was essentially a coup by the army, which really remained in control all through those years. I mean, the Brotherhood was in charge, but the Brotherhood under Mohamed Morsi never actually controlled the levers of power. Libya was totally different. I mean, Libya had never really been much of a state prior to Gaddafi coming along in 1969. It had historically been three different regions, and it was far enough from Istanbul that the Ottomans never even exercised much control over it. It gained a king, Idris, after World War I, thanks to the British, but even Idris never really seemed very interested in ruling it as a single country. He was kicked over very easily by Gaddafi in 1969, bloodlessly, and then Gaddafi built enough of a state to maintain his own power, but deliberately prevented the growth of any kind of state that would be independent of him. So the army was kind of a joke. He undermined it in all kinds of ways. He undermined any other potential institution as well. He kept the oil flowing, but that was about it. So when he fell, there was just nothing there, more than any other country. Mm-hmm. There was a complete and utter void. And I think it's one of the questions that's often been asked since then is, what could the U.S. have done, what could anybody have done to avoid the collapse that's happened there? And I'm not sure anybody could have done anything. I don't think if the U.S. had decided, for instance, not to support the NATO intervention, Gaddafi would have really maintained control. He might have retaken Benghazi, but I think the rebellion would have continued, and I think Libya would have ended up in a state of civil war, perhaps much like Syria. I think Gaddafi probably would have fallen eventually. I also think that, you know, after Gaddafi fell, for the United States to have played a much stronger role, which is a lot of people have advocated, would have been a better solution. Could also have been dangerous, could have provoked a lot of reaction. Chris Stevens, who was killed in 2012 there, knew more about Libya than practically any other American, certainly any American I knew. And he was not in favor of a heavy American footprint. He didn't want to do that. I think what happened in Libya is a tragedy, but it's not an American tragedy, it's a Libyan tragedy. They had a moment at the end of 2011 when they might have disarmed the militias. I know some Libyan political figures who were advocating for that. But everybody else said, look, we're too exhausted. We've just been fighting for 8 months. It's not the time now. And the moment passed.
Well, one of the things that's really fascinating about your book is that you spend time telling us about people in these countries and the way in which they responded to the situations they found themselves in. And in Libya, you spoke a lot with a rebel commander who was trying to make sense of his own brother's capture and ultimate torture and then ultimate death. And this rebel commander, if I understood the story correctly, then ends up capturing his brother's jailer and spends a lot of time both trying to understand the reasons why his brother's jailer did this, but then also debating with himself about what was the best course of action now that the regime had fallen, what was going to be the justice, the correct result. Could you tell us a little bit about him and about
Sure.
that story and Yeah. what it tells us about the way in which Libya is managing post-Gaddafi?
Yeah. Well, I met the members of this brigade, which formed in August 2011, right around the time when Tripoli fell to the rebels. And they had been, most of them, in a kind of makeshift jail where there had been all kinds of horrible torture practiced on them. And many of their fellow prisoners had been killed in the last moments of the regime control in Tripoli when a bunch of guards began throwing grenades into this shed where they were kept and then machine gunned them and killed most of them, almost all of them. But there was another sort of annex to the prison where more people had survived. And so they and their relatives formed this brigade and almost immediately began chasing down the guys who'd kept them in prison, along with other regime figures. And they eventually created their own headquarters, and they kept these guys in this basement with a bunch of mattresses on the floor and a kind of makeshift lock on the door. It was a strange situation. I mean, I spent a lot of time there and watched them interacting with these people. The investigator, he called himself, for the brigade was Nasser, who was a really poignant figure. He was kind of a screw-up of his family, and he'd spent long years addicted to drugs and had been involved in smuggling, and his parents were kind of ashamed of him. He'd wanted to be a police commander when he was younger, but he'd actually gotten in huge trouble, mainly because another brother in the family had been killed at a soccer stadium when Gaddafi's guards opened up on the crowd. And Nasser had been so angry at that he'd run into his own police quarters where he was training, holding a gun and shouting, and that was it for his career. So this was a chance after the revolution for him to fulfill his ambition to be an investigator. And he did. He helped to track these guys down and bring them in, and they created their own, you know, homemade jail. And he found the people. There were a few of them who had killed his brother. This is not the one who was killed in the soccer stadium, but another one brother. This brother had been the real shining star of the family. He'd been a pediatrician, a very idealistic man who had studied in England and had come back to Libya. His wife had urged him to stay in England. It'd be better for the family and for his daughters, but he said, no, I got to do something for people there. And he had treated protesters during the fighting of 2011, and then finally he was caught and put in this jail. He was a frail guy, and his fellow prisoners tried to help him, but he was killed again in the final hours of this fighting in Tripoli. For Nasser, it was a real struggle because he wanted to kill this guy. He wanted to take revenge, but he didn't allow himself to do so. And actually, I think all the men in that brigade had faced that at one point or another. They had moments when they could have killed people. Who knows, maybe some of them did, but I know I spoke to some of them who, you know, had really resisted that. Not necessarily with anyone who'd actually killed their own brother, but with members of the regime who had blood on their hands. And they really, really believed that it made a big difference not to do that. That this was the moment when they were going to be creating something new, and it really mattered. And that was a moment when I was pretty optimistic about Libya more generally. The elections of 2012 went pretty well, July 2012. The government that was elected was a non-Islamist government that seemed fairly capable. And there was still a lot of hope that they might take over from the militias, and Libya had oil, seemed as if it could be self-sufficient. But that fell apart. You know, there wasn't enough belief in Libya as a country. Too many of the communities were totally unwilling to relinquish their power. And there were too many thugs with weapons. And the government didn't have enough power, and it fell apart.
So that story for me really, I think, raises this whole question of what were they hoping to achieve, right? With the overthrow of these seemingly dictatorial regimes, what was the hope? Was there a sort of a basic sense that there was another kind of government that might be more just, that there might be some basis of law and order in the society? And it seemed like Nasser was hoping that there would be a government who could help to deliver that justice in this case, and it didn't work out that way.
Yeah. I think a lot of these people would have trouble articulating exactly what they wanted. You know, they wanted a state. That's the word that always came up. Dawla is the Arabic word, and it sort of suggests not just state, but rule of law. They found that there just wasn't enough desire for that, and not enough cohesion in the society to support those demands. You know, it's funny. There's a Syrian intellectual from the 19th century who wrote about what it takes to resist despotism. The title of the book actually is called "The Characteristics of Despotism and the Struggle Against Enslavement." His name was Abdulrahman Kawakibi, and he said there are two conditions: you have to fight despotism nonviolently, and secondly, its replacement must be ready. Mm-hmm. And that second one, I think. I mean, after all, they did, many of these rebels remained nonviolent for a long time, not in Libya, but in other countries. They were extraordinarily brave in their refusal to pick up weapons. But the second criterion, that their replacement must be ready, is the tougher one. And I think they really failed that test.
So in Syria, the other country that you tackle in the book, the story is different yet striking. And I think what I'd like you to think about for us is, how did a popular uprising against a dictatorial regime devolve so rapidly into sectarian violence?
I think everybody knew from the beginning that Syria was going to be tougher than the other countries. For precisely that reason. Well, two reasons. One was that Bashar al-Assad's state was a police state, was very, very brutal. And number two, that you had this very, very toxic sectarian history. That history did not mean that, you know, the outcome, all this horrible sectarian fighting, was inevitable. It didn't have to be that way. After all, I think in Tunisia, where you had the real possibility, what could have been a very ugly outcome, was avoided by very responsible political leaders. But that's not what you had in Syria. In Syria, you had a government that was determined to exploit those tensions and those suspicions to keep people divided, which was what they had been doing, really, in a different way for decades. These dictatorships kept a lid on all those sectarian troubles, but they never tried to resolve them. They counted on those differences to prevent anyone from uniting against them.
Hmm. So in the book, you also tell a really heart-wrenching story about two young women in Syria, Alia and Noura, and one an Alawite and the other a Sunni, who were long friends, young girls who grew up together and were really best friends in 2011, and who didn't seem to mind or didn't seem to be aware of the fact that they perhaps should not be friends. But the story that you tell shows how quickly that could change. And so I wonder if you might tell us a little bit about them and about what you see as the reasons why that friendship devolved so rapidly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, they had been friends for a long time. And I think religion hadn't really been important to either of them or their families. And their families were close too, not just the women. But once the uprising began, they began to hear completely different versions of what was going on. They saw a certain amount of it themselves, but they filtered even what they saw through these different lenses. For Noura, the Sunni woman, everything was coming from Al Jazeera. She was hearing about it from relatives who were thrilled about this. It was a popular uprising. Anything that she saw that suggested violence or sectarianism, she was probably prepared to undervalue and sort of dismiss. Aliyah, it was the opposite. She was hearing everything from her Alawi relatives, and as far as she was concerned, this was, a Wahhabi, religious-oriented terrorist threat. And that she thought that her friend Noura was just being deluded about it, that it was inevitably going to turn into a vicious sectarian campaign directed from Saudi Arabia. Of course, Noura thought that the government side was all being directed from Iran. So they read so much into everything that they saw and heard, and eventually those two worlds just became exclusive. I mean, absolutely, they couldn't live in the same space anymore. And so eventually, Noura and her family had to flee the country. Ended up in Turkey, where the physical distance made it all that much easier to believe your version of events, mm-hmm. and to disbelieve anything coming from the other side.
Well, so the role of social media in all of this, on the one hand, we were painted a pretty rosy picture of how much social media helped drive events in Egypt early on. And I wonder if you might juxtapose that to the way in which the media and information and the speed with which information or disinformation could be shared in Syria contributed to the situation.
Sure. It certainly helped to organize protests. I remember talking to the mother of one of the guys who was very important in the first protests, and she had been a protester back in the 70s in Egypt, and she said, this stuff is fantastic. I mean, back then we were running around passing notes, and it was so hard to get anybody to come out. On the other hand, I think social media tends to promote a certain kind of shallowness. There's a limit to how much you can say. You can trade in slogans, but it's hard to really prepare people for the kinds of sacrifices they have to make if they're going to take this really seriously and do it in the longer term. And also, social media is a great carrier for the worst kinds of causes as well. I mean, nobody is better at social media than ISIS. And they have spread their message all over the world. I mean, there are ISIS propagandists in Australia who have effectively, lured people to ISIS from there, and they travel all the way to Syria and blow themselves up. So it's definitely two-faced.
So in Syria, perhaps today, or at least in the near past, how much information is available about the way in which the conflict is being portrayed and interpreted by other countries? How much do they see the United States or Europe or Turkey as influencers of what's happening in Syria?
They certainly tend to see themselves as the victims of a vast international conspiracy. That's true of both sides. Mm-hmm. If you're talking to Alawis living in the Northwest under government control, they believe the United States and Israel and Saudi Arabia and all are in bed together, orchestrating this terrible, violent thing against them. the members of the opposition, which is mostly Sunni, feel that they tend to feel that, strangely enough, the United States is, at a minimum, ignoring them and failing to help them. At worst, is sort of helping to perpetuate this. They tend also to just, you know, they watch different television stations, they listen to different radio, they hear different rumors. And there's a really self-confirming aspect of a lot of the media.
So I'm going to come to everyone's questions here in a moment, but I did want to take one last look at one of the other countries that you look at in the book, and that's Yemen, and just ask you about the events in Yemen and what sets it apart from the way in which these attempts at revolution unfolded in the other countries. Yemen is the country that I understand the least, that I know the least about myself, so I'd love it if you'd spend a little time and talk to us about what's happened in Yemen.
Sure. Yemen was a country where I think people were most surprised that an uprising took place at all, because it's always been seen as something of a backwater. It's very tribal. You know, the feeling among many Arabs in Cairo and places like that was, you know, Yemen, my God, they're still in the 12th century. You know, why would they have an uprising? Actually, their uprising was fascinating. I've spent a lot of time in Yemen before 2011. I love the place. Their uprising actually, as far as the sit-in was concerned, lasted longer than any of the others. It started in January 2011, lasted until about November. You know, there were stragglers, but that's when I think most of the people began to leave. And something happened in that uprising that was kind of fascinating. There was it was so large and so long-lasting that you had schools and things and, you know, sort of an urban culture that for many of the people there was new, because Yemen is still mostly rural. People live out in the villages and in the desert. And they were encountering each other in new ways. There was something very productive and good going on. Unfortunately, the deal that was made to get rid of the dictator there, Ali Abdullah Saleh, was mishandled. He was given immunity from any prosecution and was allowed to stay in the country, and power was transferred to his deputy, Hadi. At first, that looked to some people like a success, because it was much less violent than it could have been, there was a transition. And there was also something called a national dialogue, which was everybody getting together in this hotel up on a hill in Sana'a, and all the different parties, and talking about how to get past their differences. The trouble was that what was happening in that hotel did not reflect what was happening in the rest of the country. There were multiple insurgencies taking place. And part of the problem in Yemen is that it's such a fragmented country, and it's so difficult to get around, mountains and deserts and so forth. It's difficult to know what's happening in those places. And I think there was a kind of disconnect there. The United States trusted too much in that limited dialogue and the hopes that that would ramify to the rest of the country, when something like the opposite happened. The Houthi rebels up in the northwest began to advance gradually. They ended up taking over the capital and going all the way to the south. Southern Yemen, which had a very different history and political trajectory from the north, was never really that much involved in the uprisings. And what they wanted was secession. They wanted to create their own country. That's a long-standing goal. It was a separate country for a long time. What you have now is just a terrible mess, where because the Houthis had some limited backing from Iran, much, much less than has been advertised by various parties involved, but still, they've gotten support from Iran. And so that was enough for the Saudis to launch this disastrous war against the Houthis, which is still going on. Any hopes for progress have really been destroyed, because that war has allowed Al-Qaeda and ISIS to flourish. And I mean, the number of armed groups that you might run across now in Yemen has just multiplied and multiplied. It's going to take a long, long time before they get back on track.
So what is the Saudis' end game in Yemen, in your view?
I wish they had one. they started this war because they wanted to send a message to Iran. The Saudis were feeling humiliated by Iran. They felt that, you know, Iran was encroaching them in all kinds of ways. For a very long time, felt very angry about Hezbollah, which they see, of course, as an Iranian cat's paw in Lebanon. It's the most powerful force in Lebanon. And in Iraq, they see Iran very, very powerful in a country that they used to see as a bulwark of Sunni Arab power and influence. And then they saw this group, the Houthis, again, a small, you know, marginal group in northwestern Yemen. Nobody really cared about them until a few years ago. And they were getting some fairly minor support. The support got stronger later on, after the Saudis had been advertising it and exaggerating it for a long time. But the Saudis at that point felt insecure. They felt that they couldn't count on the Americans anymore. And they wanted to prove to the world, and especially their own people, that they were powerful and relevant. So they launched this war to, you know, essentially to sort of shake their fist at Iran. But the war's actual strategy was very poorly thought out. They were dropping bombs from very, very high because they were afraid of any aircraft fire. They missed a lot of their targets. They killed a lot of civilians. They've generated a lot of anger. They have failed to achieve their goals in terms of, they've retaken some places. They took the southern city of Aden, but the Houthis still remain in control of much of the country. And that is partly because the old dictator never left. And he teamed up with the Houthis. He's an extremely, extremely crafty man. And even though he's old and ill, it's still hard to say who's really going to win at the end of the day.
So I'm going to turn to some of your questions. And because we're talking about multiple countries, we may jump around a little bit. So I hope that's OK.
Sure.
I'm going to come back to Libya because I have a question that's focused on Libya. And I think the real point of this is a question about information and how much of the reporting and information about what happened in Libya have we gotten, and how much can we rely on it? We can certainly raise the issue of what we understand about what happened in Benghazi, but this questioner is asking about the day that Gaddafi himself was captured and killed, and his son was shown on BBC in prison, apparently unharmed, and then was later reported having been killed. And so the questioner is really asking, to what extent is that information? Can we rely on that information, or, you know, was it really disinformation?
Well, I think Gaddafi and his son were certainly killed by rebels who wanted revenge, and unfortunately, I just don't think those rebels. That was the time at which it became clear that these rebels were not answering to any organized authority. I think that the guys who killed Gaddafi and possibly also his son were from Misrata, which is a city in the west of Libya that saw some of the worst fighting in the spring of 2011. And it's always been a city that had a certain amount of independence. They felt, partly because they'd fought so hard, that they had the right to represent themselves and make their own decisions and to have a strong voice and whatever outcome there was in Libya. And they didn't feel that those fighters didn't feel that they needed to appeal to any authority, that they needed to wait, apparently. Or maybe perhaps nobody just had the power to restrain the guys who happened to be there with a gun. But that's precisely the problem in Libya. There are all these groups, and I mean, it's dizzying to talk about, you know, who's in charge. It's changed over time. You basically have two groups, you know, one run by this guy who used to work for Gaddafi, Khalifa Haftar, who has support from Egypt and the Emirates. And then you have another group that includes a bunch of Islamists who are mostly in charge in the West. But there are other groups that are part of neither of those coalitions, and the territory control by the different groups has shifted back and forth. The oil is no longer accessible. I mean, it's just everything is really falling apart.
So one place that we haven't talked about is Tunisia. Tunisia being really the starting point. And I think one of the key questions for us to understand better is why is it that Tunisia seems to have been able to emerge from the events of the Arab Spring with some semblance of stability? What makes it different than the other countries?
Tunisia had a lot going for it from the beginning. It's a small country. It's closer to Europe physically, and I think there was a lot of European influence there. Not that that's better than anything else, but it's an international influence. There was more of a sense of international comparison there. It doesn't have a lot of the gunpowder of the other countries in the region. There's no oil. The army was weak and apolitical. The population, at least in the urban centers, was relatively well-educated and had better health care. The dictator, or autocrat, maybe is a better word, who was in charge of Tunisia in the post-war years, Habib Bourguiba, was a pretty good dictator, as dictators go, much less brutal than some of the other Arab autocrats. He was a deep believer in the importance of education and women's rights. Of course, he had a rigidly secularist view of those things. All the same, he wasn't bad as far as dictators go. And another thing that I think was equally important was that what you have in Tunisia is an Islamist group that is very moderate and run by a very, very sophisticated, responsible man, Rashid Khanouchi, who has learned, he's really been able to learn from his experiences. The comparison between that group and Nahda and the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood is really striking. I mean, the leaders of the Brotherhood, they're not well-traveled, you know, they haven't read widely, they're much more rigid in their thinking. They weren't able to adapt, whereas Khanouchi really was. He grew up reading Marx and Freud and all this other stuff. He traveled around Europe. He learned from the leftist movement in the 70s in Tunisia in a way that some Islamist leaders in other parts of the Arab world did not. That was just anathema to them. And Khanouchi was able to say, sure, they're secular, but there are things that they do that are admirable, and let's integrate that. Tunisia had the advantage that they saw what had just happened in Egypt in 2013. They saw this horrible polarization taking place. They saw the military coup and what happened afterward, this massacre of the Islamists. And I think the Islamists, but even to some extent the secularists, realized they didn't want to go down that road. And that helped people to compromise. The Islamist Party had won the first elections in 2011, but they had made a bunch of very bad mistakes after that. And so things really reached a pretty dangerous state by the summer of 2013. But the two sides were able to come together because the leaders of the two main political groups, Khanouchi, the Islamists, and Beji Caid Essebsi with the secularists, were able to sit down together and establish some trust and bring their respective political parties on board. And so what you got was real concessions a constitution that everybody could agree on. And Nahda stepped down voluntarily from power, which is something that Mohamed Morsi was never willing to even consider in Egypt. And so you got, you know, a so-called government of national unity that is still struggling on. There's tremendous challenges in Tunisia, including all these bombings and a terrible economy. But it's got ingredients that these other countries don't have.
So I think you've actually answered this question, and that this comes from the audience, and that is which of these countries has the best future and why. If we take Tunisia as being that country, are there any others that you would suggest might have a bright future at this point?
Not the ones I write about in this book. I mean, you know, I think, you know, you have to keep a long time frame, and that's the only way to be hopeful about it. And even Tunisia, as I say, is, you know, is has all kinds of serious threats. One of the interesting things in this to me is that in some ways the monarchies in the Middle East have been better off than the republics. Now, in some cases, that's just because they have more money. You know, I mean, the Saudis can throw endless amounts of money at the problem, and people will shut up and take it. But Morocco, actually, has made reforms. It's still a monarchy, you know, let's face it. It's not a democracy, and if the king has his way, it never will be. But they've made some incremental reforms over the years, and I think one could argue that the monarchies have a certain kind of social legitimacy that the republics didn't have. You know, there's a kind of a public trust and a certain kind of religious sanction for monarchy in that part of the world. And I think many people are willing to give kings a certain latitude and leeway that they might not give to someone who proclaims himself a democrat and then proceeds to act like the worst kind of monarch.
So I guess the other side of the coin is, are there other countries in the region that are vulnerable, that are at risk of seeing revolution spread, or is Syria sort of the last?
No. There's lots of others. Well, I don't know about lots, but Algeria is a big worry. I mean, you know, they went through that horrible civil war in the 90s, but it is still controlled by this little military clique. And Bouteflika, the president, is, you know, dying. I mean, he seems to be in death's door. But apparently the military cabal that rules the country can't agree on somebody else. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure, you know, there's Islamist insurgency brewing under the surface, although they've been very good at keeping that down. So I think it's a big concern what's going to happen there. I think the memory of what happened in the 90s has been a pretty effective object lesson. People don't want to go back to that. Same thing in Lebanon. You know, people for a long time felt, look, we lived through that war. Let's not do it again. I'm not that worried about Lebanon just because its very dysfunctionality prevents, in some ways, an equally bad cataclysm from breaking out. And in a strange way, Hezbollah, which is viewed as such a threatening force in Lebanon for many good reasons, is also a force for stability. I mean, they have the guns, they have the power. They are the only force in Lebanon that can really stop ISIS from blowing that country up. And I think the United States, while it doesn't want to deal with Hezbollah, you know, recognizes that fact. And the Israelis may even recognize that fact, even though they would love to get rid of Hezbollah. Mm-hmm. Saudi Arabia, I think, is, you know, fairly stable. You know, you often hear projections that the House of Saud is going to fall. I don't believe that's going to take place. But in a longer term, yeah, I mean, they have all kinds of issues. They have not been successful so far at diversifying their economy away from oil. They have a huge demographic bulge of younger people, who many of whom feel hopeless and you know, stymied by life in that country, where you know, there's no public entertainment. It's hard to get jobs. Just a deep sense of frustration, and, you know, tremendous limits on civil rights and so forth. Let me think if there's other obvious examples. Those are the big ones, I'd say.
Those are the big ones. Well, so let's turn to one of the, what I would call, the elephants in the room. This questioner asked, did the Arab Spring contribute to the rise of ISIS, and was or is ISIS an inevitable result?
I think a lot of things contributed to the rise of ISIS, mm-hmm. Among them the American invasion of Iraq in 2003. And we'd also have to include, I think, Obama's, I think, hasty withdrawal from Iraq in 2011. I think that was a big mistake on Obama's part. I think we should have kept some residual force there. And even apart from the question of, you know, negotiating that residual force, I think the United States could have pushed harder to prevent Maliki from behaving in such a sectarian way. It just, I mean, it was a boon for ISIS, or rather the group that became ISIS. It really left Iraqi Sunnis with the sense that they had nowhere else to turn. You know, they felt the Iranians were taking over their country, and it's true that there were Shiite death squads that many of them had real fears of being killed by. They didn't like ISIS, but they didn't feel like anybody else was there to protect them. And in some ways, ISIS was as they felt, protecting them. I think you could say that the revolts were one factor, but I think I would say the other thing that really made ISIS possible was Bashar al-Assad, the ruler of Syria, because the way that he chose to respond to the revolt opened the door to ISIS. The mere fact of an insurrection in other parts of the Arab world did not require him to behave the way he did.
So if ISIS is in fact the enemy now, then why are we continuing with the war against Assad? Are the Russians right that the best solution is to support the Assad regime?
I don't think so, because I was just saying that Assad is part of the reason for ISIS. I think there's a kind of strange symbiotic relationship across the Middle East now between dictators and terrorist groups. It's the kind of repression that Assad carried out that helps to generate this stuff. And in fact, it's no accident that many of the leading commanders in ISIS are former Iraqi military commanders. Mm-hmm. You know, this was a regime where brutal torture was so widespread. Many of the people who carried that out and sanctioned it are now doing it under a different name. You know, many of them became more devout Muslims, or rather, maybe better to say, more extreme fanatical Muslims, starting in the 90s under what Saddam Hussein called the Faith Campaign. Saddam thought that he could sort of protect himself against the Islamist wave with a kind of inoculation. But it worked the other way. A lot of these men who had seemed to be old-style secularist military commanders ended up becoming Islamist military commanders with all the expertise that you got from being part of Saddam Hussein's military, but as with the agenda that ISIS then carried out.
So we have a hard time understanding really what the appeal of ISIS is, and you recently actually did a piece about a Jordanian who went off to fight for ISIS was ultimately a reluctant jihadi. Would you tell us a little bit about what you learned?
Sure.
From talking with him?
Well, he was one of many people his life had just fallen apart. In his specific case, he was living in Aleppo, which was a terrible place to be at that time. It was really coming apart with insurgency and bombings by the regime. But I think he was one of a lot of people now who just feel that, their country had fallen apart. The whole region seemed to be falling apart. They didn't know what to believe. They didn't see a future for themselves or for their families. In that moment of crisis, I think a lot of people just reached out for whatever the most uncompromising and powerful force nearby, whatever that would be. For many of them, it was a group that seemed to have an answer to every problem. One of the appeals of apocalyptic narratives is that they give you that kind of answer. They tell you, you're not just floating along through space, not knowing where things start and end. You are in exactly this place. You're near the end of time. Here's what's going to happen, and here's your role in it. You're at an important time in the grand narrative of this universe. Even if the answer is something horrifying, like you got to blow yourselves up in front of a checkpoint, if you suddenly feel that this is going to provide your life with a meaning and a purpose, a lot of people will go for it.
So the other elephant in the room, I'll come back to where we started, and several people have asked, what, if any, role can the U.S. play in stabilizing the situation in the Middle East?
I don't think there's an awful lot the U.S. can do. I think there are things, the United States is doing some things, certainly helping refugees, doing humanitarian work, which the government has been doing. I think we could probably do more of that. It is also possible that that the Obama administration could have done more to rein in the violence in one way or another, you know, to stop the barrel bombings by Assad, to prevent all these countries that allowed their people to go off as jihadis, or for instance, in the case of Turkey, to open its doors to all these jihadis to go right through. I think that with more foresight, perhaps the administration could have organized the situation around Syria better and prevented it from becoming this sort of crazy, you know, quilt of all kinds of different radical groups. It's hard to undo that now. I think, you know, there's only a couple of positive of things going on in the region as far as I can see now. One of them is Tunisia, and I think the U.S. should be providing more support to Tunisia, I think, especially economically, because that's the key there. The U.S. is always very quick to step up and say, well, we'll offer you special forces or we'll train your military, this kind of stuff. And that's helpful for Tunisia, but I think economic help is even more important. The region needs a success story because that will ramify across not just North Africa, but I think the entire Arab world and make a big difference. Another thing that I think may be happening, it's happening in small ways, is a move toward local governance. A lot of these countries were way too centralized, not just because they were dictatorships, but because the whole government structure was built for everything to run through the capital. Before 2011, some of Bashar al-Assad's advisors were telling him, you need to start letting mayors in towns around Syria make their own decisions, just because it would help the economy. You know, a more flexible government where decisions are made faster allows business to grow and so forth, and then, you know, things will get better. And so again, these were economic advisors. They didn't care about the political consequences. But Bashar said no, on the advice of some of his more political advisors, including his cousins, because they feared, well, what if some of these guys, sure, they might be good for the economy, but what if their brotherhood, you know, what if they end up presenting a political challenge to us? We can't have that. I think that logic is one thing that should change. It's hard to talk about that now in Syria with the whole country divided up, you know, into different zones. But before Yemen fell apart, they were talking about a decentralization plan that would devolve a lot more power to the provinces and to the cities. And Tunisia is considering something very similar right now. I think that would help. And if there's anything the U.S. can do to assist with that, that would be great.
Trying to think of how to phrase this. So if Syria is essentially a hopeless case, and Libya is essentially a hopeless case, and there are other countries here that may fall in this category as well, Iraq, will we be seeing a new effort to redraw the borders in a different way? Do we need to go back to a Sykes-Picot-type discussion about changing all of the boundaries?
I don't think so. I think a lot of that talk is exaggerated. I mean, it takes an enormous effort to draw new borders, and I don't think anybody has the patience for that. I mean, certainly the United States has no interest in spearheading that, and probably nobody else is going to do it either. I mean, the one country where that may happen is Iraqi Kurdistan, which is essentially its own country already. That may become official at some point. In other places, I just think it's going to be, you know, I don't think Syria for a long, long time, if ever, is going to go back to what it was. But I think effectively it'll be divided into three zones, You know, the Kurds in northeastern Syria have declared this statelet, they call it Rojava, where because they really are quite unified, they may make a decent go of it. Will that eventually turn into its own state? Maybe, but I think, again, that just takes an awful lot of international agreement to make that happen. And I think in terms of these countries being hopeless, I think it's important to look at what's happening locally. I mean, there are places in Syria where good things are happening. You know, people are trying to build schools and where, you know, local ceasefires are happening and where cross-sectarian work is being done. That doesn't change the fact that the country overall is facing real structural problems, that, you know, the area where ISIS rules is a mostly Sunni area, and they see not just the Shiites in Iraq and the Alawi-dominated government in western Syria as a huge threat. They also see the Kurds as a huge threat. So, you know, how are you going to reconquer that area, for one thing, and then secondly, how is it going to be governed in the future? Suppose we kick ISIS out. Who's gonna run that part of Syria and Iraq? I don't think anybody has a good answer right now.
Mm-hmm. So of all the people that you talk about in the work that you've done, are there any that you're in touch with today that you would say are doing well or happy?
Some are doing okay, yeah. I don't think any of them are delighted except the ones, no, not even those. I mean, the ones who left. In some ways, actually, the hardest thing is when you leave. You know, I know a lot of Syrians who've gotten out. And what they find, I mean, obviously the immediate threats to their lives come to an end. But then they get, many of them have gotten very depressed because they're still thinking about it all the time and there's nothing they can do. I mean, at least if you're in the thick of it, you know, day to day, it consumes you. I remember talking to a couple of Iraqis years ago. This is way before the 2011 uprising started. It was in London, and they had both moved there, but they had just gotten there. And I was sitting with them in the backyard of my cousin, who's English, and she's a therapist, and we started talking about post-traumatic stress disorder. And they both said, wait, we haven't gotten to the post yet. I think, it's tough for all of them, you know, even if they manage to establish sort of a beachhead and a better life, there's a long, long transition.
Well, the story that you tell and the picture that you paint is not a rosy one. But I would recommend to all of you the work because it's a very insightful one and a very interesting one to know and understand more about. So that is all the time that we have for tonight. So please, on behalf of the World Affairs Council, join me in thanking Robert Wirth for this excellent discussion.